Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, dignitaries on the dais, off the dais, distinguished guests, participants, my colleagues from the State Bank of India. It is indeed a great pleasure for me to be here today and participate in these discussions. I feel a little bit embarrassed when you call me chief guest and amongst the doyens of the industry and who have helped shape the future of real estate industry in the country. We at State Bank of India, yes, we also have made some contribution, but it goes to the credit of Mr. Hiranandani, DLF, RR Cable, who support the industry. So these are the real doyens, but still I would like to share a few thoughts, and many of these thoughts have already been captured. And when I was listening to Mr. Niranjan Hiranandani, so initially I thought that he was speaking from the industry, and later on I realized that he can be a very successful politician also if he decides to fight the elections. He's such a powerful speaker, and then we had a very nice presentation from Peter on the REITs. So if I look back, as an individual and as a banker, and then I say as an individual, so I am a typical, I would call a middle class salaried person, and who has seen this market evolve. And Mr. Hiranandani went to 15 years, and I want to go back to 50 years. So what my father did, so he saved all his life till retirement to buy a house. I joined the State Bank of India in 1980, and after 5 years at the first opportunity in 1985, with the help of the State Bank of India, I had my first house. So that was the difference. A few more examples. So my brother, who is a central government servant, so he bought a flat in DDA. So that was a lottery at that time in mid-80s, and then DDA decided, and they used to do it very frequently, that the price of a flat which was 200,000 rupees, so they wanted 50,000 more. And he was not a banker and he was a central government. So he thought that Rajnish Kumar is the best person who my brother call contact and he will help. And then when he told me very, you know, very despondent, very worried, I should surrender the flat or what do? I don't have that 50,000 rupees. And the only name which came to my mind at that time, I told my brother, please go and try HDFC. And that's how he could retain his flat. And then come 92, liberalization happened. And then private sector banks like HDFC Bank, ICICI, Axis, and followed by banks like State Bank of India and public sector bank. And the housing loan market started opening up. And that was, I would call, a watershed year. And between 96 to 2016, I am very proud that the State Bank of India has become the leader in this market with a 25% market share. And we run neck to neck with HDFs. So that is the change story. But a few more examples. My same brother, he wanted to buy a house, flat, not house, in Dwarka, and that was 2004. And he lost 3 deals because the situation was that as soon as you see the property and you write a check, and if you don't do that, the property is gone. And ultimately, he became so desperate that the top floor in that building, and the broker said, Mr. Prasad, I said, you write the check or this thing. And because he had become so desperate, he just did not see anything, wrote the check and sealed the deal. Come 2008, 2009, his sons, they booked 2 flats with different builders, very different builders in Gurgaon, NCR area. And that was 2008, 2009, paid a decent sum of money, and they still today are struggling, having sleepless nights because construction is not complete. they are against elite class people, and possession of the flat is nowhere in sight. So we have seen all in this space of last 20 years. And if I analyze it as a banker, so what went wrong? And housing sector or real estate sector is no exception. When you had the possibility that you make an investment today and 3 years it will double, so obviously the excesses were committed. They were bound to happen. And I don't blame only the real estate industry, even the buyer, investor. Everybody was thinking that you just buy it today, there is no tomorrow, and after 4 years you just exit. That was the mentality with the developers, that was the mentality of the buyers, that was the mentality of the investors. So 25% return, 30% return, but sooner or later this party was to end, and it has ended. But it does not mean that there is no future. Here is the time where the foundation of a future, where the business on sound principles can now be built and run it. Those time of 25-30% return are over. They will not be there. And mind it, even 15-18%, everything you have to relate to inflation, even the interest rates, you have to relate to inflation. When India inflation was 9-10%, obviously the rate of interest was 15-16%. But if inflation comes down and has come down to 4-5%, so it is very reasonable that the interest rates would be in the region of 8-9%. And again, Mr. Hanani spoke of the contradiction in the society, and there is. So on the one hand, we are talking about 20 million dwelling units in urban area and 45 million in rural area. So there is a demand. And on the other hand, if you drive through NCR or Bombay or suburbs or anywhere, so there is a huge inventory of flats lying. And again, it is not only in the real estate sector. I take another example, power sector. So our power plants, they are running at a generation capacity or PLF of 60%. But if we travel across UP, we will find that most of the households, they are running on the generator set, which costs them 15-16 rupees per unit. So demand is there. Capacity is underutilized. Similar situation in housing sector. Capacity, excess supply, I am unable to figure out whether we are in excess demand situation or we are in excess supply situation. It's a dilemma. And why so? What are the reasons around that? And again, I would say that each of the stakeholders has some thing to contribute, and of course the governments, because they think this is the sector which they can milk, and government is the largest owner of the land in this country, and for the various reasons the supply of the land has not been commensurate to the demand. And that's why all the costs you talk about, and that is the reality, that if 10,000 per square feet goes to the government, where can the housing or affording housing can come? The cost of construction, I don't think it has gone up that much. It is the cost of the land and the taxes and the fees and the transaction costs. So they are the contributing factor. And how can we have a affordable housing in this country unless those costs are brought down? So definitely state governments have a very critical role to play. As far as the real estate industry is concerned, or builder community is concerned, the time of keeping the projects open forever, I think that time is also over. So I've seen, I've lived in UK, I've lived in Canada, and the construction is very fast. So it is not only the elements which state government brings in, but even when the land is in possession and the approvals are in place, even after that, the time it takes to construct is very long. And then there are the financing costs associated with it, and then they get loaded into the cost. So even if the rate of interest is 9% or 10%, but if the project gets completed in 4 years, the financing cost adds to significantly to the project. And there are technologies available, there are building materials available. We are in a 12 months time, I believe that, or maybe at best 15 months time, it should be able to complete a project, multi-storied project. And there are countries where this is happening. And this does help in bringing down the cost of the project. At least IDC, interest during construction, you are able to save. Another thing which we need to look at and we need to work, and that is what the whole purpose of